रिकॉर्डिंग का प्रोसेस है।
On behalf of the museum, I welcome everyone present here today for Dr. Kavita Singh's talk. As you may already know, Dr. Kavita Singh is an art historian and an associate professor at the School of Arts and Aesthetics in JNU. She has also been a research editor, Mark Publications, and guest curator at the San Diego Museum of Art. Her publications include New Insights into Sikh Art and essays in several international and national journals. She was co-curator of Power and Desire, Indian Paintings from the Binay Collection, an exhibition of Indian miniature paintings that traveled through the US, Europe, and Asia. She has received a grant from the Getty Foundation in 2005 for a collaborative project to study the place of museums in the social landscape of India today. We are delighted to have her speak today on the future of ethnographic museums. Welcome, Dr. Kavita Singh. And if you have any questions, we'll take these up after the talk.
I was stuck in it for a good long while myself, so very grateful that all of you made the trek. And thank you very much also for coming for what promises to be a somewhat esoteric talk. I don't know how many of you lie awake at night dreaming and worrying about the future of the ethnographic museum. I'm sure it doesn't occupy a great deal of your waking and sleeping thoughts, so it's very kind of you to come. Now, I actually wrote this paper in response to an invitation to a conference which was being held at the Pitt Rivers Museum in the University of Oxford, which is one of the archetypal ethnographic museums of the world. You know, it's one of those old school, when there were people in solar topis stomping all over the place, grabbing what they want, taking it and putting it under their microscopes and magnifying lenses. And of course, museums of that kind, and there are many, in today's day and age are seized with anxieties about what kind of role they might possibly make for themselves in the current historical juncture. So they had a conference in which they were asking the question about the future of ethnographic museums. And my response to that was that the future of museums is ethnographic. And by this, what I mean to say is that many of the conditions that those who look at the history of museums, who look at the ethics of anthropology, and therefore at what should be the role of an ethnographic museum in the world today, many of the aspects or dilemmas or particular problems that they identify as being the problems of an ethnographic museum today, many of those facets actually seem to be underlying the kinds of ways in which many different kinds of museums in the world are actually functioning. So what at first glance seems like the particular problem or the particular dilemma of the ethnographic museum, you will find that while it is being, that history is being shed and disavowed by the ethnographic museum, you will find that some of those same modes are actually coming to underlie museums that claim that they are not ethnographic. And therefore, for me, the role of the museum in the future is indeed actually an ethnographic role. And so let me try and explain what I mean by this by picking up four aspects of the what we consider or what the field considers to be the particular dilemmas of the ethnographic museum, and let me see how they are playing out in different areas or unexpected areas. So the first thing that I want to look at, which has been identified as one of the issues of the ethnographic museum, is the way in which the ethnographic museum is seen as a site in which others have been collected. This comes from the fact that the ethnographic museum today is the residue of the colonial period, when people of a certain kind had the power, had the authority, and had the reach to be able to go to the far corners of the globe and to pick up things that were sacred, things that were important in a particular place, and take them away and put them in their own museum cases. And therefore, you have the ethnographic museum as a place that is associated with the collecting of others, and therefore is also associated with a history of asymmetrical power relationships between those who collected and those who were collected. And one of the embarrassments of the Ethnographic Museum today is the way in which it remains a kind of a monument to colonialism, and the issue becomes, what do we do with the history of this asymmetry in the power relations, which are evident in the halls of the Ethnographic Museum? The second issue that is considered an issue of the Ethnographic Museum is a specific way of showing things. Because even as the Ethnographic Museum forms its collections by wrenching something out of its context and putting it in another place somewhere very far away from the place of origin, at the same time the Ethnographic Museum takes it upon itself to in some measure recreate in a partial way what was the original context of the object, so that they can explain to the viewers that this pot, for instance, was made by the women of the tribe and it was used for cooking or for storage. And the typical way in which ethnographic museums would do it in the late 19th century and into the early part of the 20th century typically would be formed through the diorama, where you have a mock-up of figures, you know, human-looking figures, and a believable kind of simulation of the environment, so that the object is inserted into a simulation of the context from which the object came. Now, this means that historically, the object which is collected by the Ethnographic Museum is seen not as an aesthetic object, not as something that should be admired for its beauty, but is seen as something that will give us information about another place, another time, you know, some people who are living somewhere else. This object comes to represent some fragment of their culture. And that is why the object in the Ethnographic Museum is valued. The third thing, which is a phenomenon of very recent times, is the way in which ethnographic museums have now become a place for the reclamation of traditions, the reclamation of heritage and culture by precisely those people who in an earlier era had been dispossessed by those who made the ethnographic museum. So if in 1885, there are some people who are wrenching, you know, some French and some English people who are wrenching things away from colonies in Africa, then today you will have people who are the descendants of the formerly colonized coming to those museums which hold their ethnographic objects that relate to their culture and their heritage and claim it in some way as a place where they can get into touch with their roots. And the Ethnographic Museum also has become a place which takes on this responsibility as a way of ethically functioning today, where they say indeed those who were dispossessed earlier have a right to come and make their voices heard in precisely the place where they had earlier been rendered mute. So that is the third aspect that we associate with the Ethnographic Museum, where it becomes a place for the formerly dispossessed to engage with their former traditions. And fourthly, the Ethnographic Museum has now become, through this process, a place in which we re-examine whether Europe had the right to take those things away in the first place, whether Europe had the right to define the terms in which those things would be considered or understood or studied or classified. So whether Europe had the right to say, well, this will no longer be worshipped, but this will be studied as a piece of the sculptor's art or not. So because that claim that Europe had under which it collected, explained, categorized these things is now under contest within the Ethnographic Museum, the Ethnographic Museum itself becomes a site in which Europe no longer becomes that hegemonic arbiter of how we should approach the world and connect with it, but Europe's own ways of dealing with the world become provincialized. Oh, this is how they used to do it in the 19th century. The Ethnographic Museum becomes a place to see that. So it becomes a place for actually the marginalization of Europe rather than the constant centralizing of Europe, which it used to be. Now, if we think of these four different kinds of concerns, a place to collect others, a way to show that which has been collected from others, a place where others may now reclaim their tradition, and a place in which Europe itself might be othered, as it were. If we think of these four things as facets or aspects of transactions in our intellectual lives that are particular to the Ethnographic Museum, what I want to say is that all four of these aspects actually underlie the way in which museums at large are functioning today. And I'm going to make my case by talking about aspects specific to art museums, but I could actually redo this whole paper by talking about the way in which science museums function by taking a different set of examples. So let's take a look at these four aspects and see how they are playing out in the world of museums at large. So let me begin by entering the first chapter of my talk by presenting, for your consideration, a very provocative remark about representing others, which was made by a very major art historian from Germany called Hans Belting. Hans Belting is a super, super famous art historian. You're seeing him during a conference presentation. He's the man at the bottom of the screen. And the presentation that he is making, which not coincidentally is showing Aboriginal art, is at the top of the screen. Now, we are seeing Hans Belting in his very recent avatar, but actually earlier in his career, he actually made his reputation by the study of medieval and Renaissance European art. And it's only in very recent years that he has turned his attention to the global world of contemporary art through a very ambitious project which is called the Global Art Museum, in which over several years, through many conferences and publications, he has been examining the formation and the circulation of what we today understand to be global contemporary art. In one of the books that Belting produced under the aegis of the project, he's discussing the way in which the contemporary art world has today become globalized because more and more artists from what were formerly the elsewheres of the world, the places that didn't participate in contemporary art, now are represented in all the big museums and the biennales and in all the art fairs. And he asks, what does this mean, their arrival? He says, where do those non-Western artists belong who just recently were included in the art market? And then he answers, I would venture to argue that contemporary art in a global context invades the space of a former ethnic production. Contemporary art in a global context invades the space of a former ethnic production. And by that, perhaps what he means is that the contemporary artists who are circulating among all the biennales and the art fairs of the world are today's equivalents of the kind of natives who were shipped in as living ethnographic exhibits in all the different world's fairs that were held all across the world in the 19th century, where you would put up a hut that would look like the Congo, and you would bring in some natives who looked like the natives of the Congo, and they would have to wear their costumes, and for the duration of the 6 months of the fair, they would have to act out their ethnicity for the visitors who came to see. Now, he is actually suggesting that the artists from elsewhere today, as they circulate in the global contemporary world, are actually replacing these natives. And this is an extremely uncomfortable thing to say. And it's also not an entirely tenable thing to say, because it cannot stand up to close scrutiny. Because we certainly cannot compare the kinds of circumstances and compulsions and the lack of choices that underwrote the participation of these people from, let's say, Guinea, who were on view in Paris in 1900, with the kinds of circumstances, the kinds of opportunities, and the kinds of rewards that are available to the globally circulating contemporary artists from elsewhere who are famous today. For example, El Anatsui, the art superstar from Ghana, who is lauded all over the world and whose artworks and exhibitions are solicited very eagerly and passionately by museums everywhere. So you cannot really compare what was the situation of those ethnographic, living ethnographic displays and a person like El Anatsui. And yet, paradoxically, if you pick up any book about contemporary art that examines the recent and the ever-quickening global circulation of art from more and more places to more and more places, you will find that all those books which are about biennales and about the global art world are completely wrapped with discussion which is about ethnography. In fact, if you read those books, it sounds like an anthropological book, because there is constant breastfeeding about the way in which artists who come from elsewhere, no matter what they do, are always marked by their origins. and they are always expected to represent the place that they came from, even if they only nominally came from the place, even if they are diasporic people who have never set foot in the native place, they are still expected to represent it. Now, whether this is happening in museum exhibitions or in biennales, these artists are supposed to always perform the function of the native informant or the cultural broker of the new age, whether this is the result of an ethnologization which is imposed by the host institution and the way they frame the participation of these artists, or whether it is the result of a self-ethnologization that the artist himself adopts because he wants to take on that position of standing for a particular place or a particular culture. I also think that if we look at the way in which art from elsewhere, you know, from new places that are just arriving on the global art scene, the way in which waves of interest in art from a particular place tends to rise, peak, and then subside, you'll see that it seems to follow a certain kind of a pattern. For a little while after the fall of communism, the art of Eastern Europe was the hottest thing. Later, it was Chinese contemporary art, which rode out a much longer surge. Now I'm beginning to hear about things like art from Burma, art from Cambodia, but I suspect that the big vogue that we are on the cusp of is actually for contemporary art from Africa. Clearly, the vectors of interest in art have a strong link with the vectors of interest in economies. And the interest in new places is actually following the opening out of economies or the coming up of economic opportunities in those places whose economies had earlier been closed or sealed off. So as we are able to economically enter a place, we become interested in the culture and the cultural productions of that place. And in that sense then, the way in which global art flows are going today are in a fundamental sense then linked to the way in which colonial art flows went, because those also followed the arc of economic interests. Now, in the course of the trend in which a particular zone or a particular country of focus becomes the flavor of the month, if one institution mounts an exhibition of art from that country, then many institutions feel that they also have to mount exhibitions. And so a lot of curators start making a lot of visits, a lot of artists start making a lot of art, a lot of critics start producing a lot of discourse. And all of this can actually do a lot of good because it can genuinely expand the canon of what we think is worthwhile. It can bring visibility and opportunities to some amazingly good artists. It can produce some very interesting events and some very interesting books. But the exhibitions, by and large, tend to be presented as a kind of a report that can reveal truths about a whole country or even a whole continent. Look at all the Africa shows, right? And they are held as though these exhibitions can serve a kind of a diagnostic function. And more often than not, interest is created in this project, and the project is given a kind of a value and even a kind of an urgency by embedding what these artists do in an overall narrative of crisis, in which the artists become these people who have survived, who have just managed to emerge from a black period, and who are finally able to tell the world what it really was like back then and out there. And you may have noticed that the book's covers that I was showing, whether they are from Europe or from China, both play up the communist past of these countries. You know, even though that may not be a very significant referent in the works that are made, because the idea is that after the black cloud of communism has lifted, finally these people are open to speak, and we are able to hear them. Now, as you would expect, post 9/11, there has been a surge in interest in Islamic art. And a number of authorities have now given the burden of explaining Islam, making Islam seem more sympathetic and more understandable. They have placed that burden on the arts of Islam. And this can be seen even in the reinstallations of the permanent collections of a number of classical museums, museum collection of Islamic art. So the Louvre redid its collection of Islamic art in a very lavish kind of redisplay. And the Metropolitan Museum of Art opened its redisplay of its Islamic galleries only last year, I think. And therefore, Islamic art has a new kind of cachet, but a similar job of making the Islamic world sympathetic, making it normalized, is also expected to be performed by contemporary Islamic art, a category that has been invented in the post 9/11 years. A prominent show of this kind was called Without Boundary, 17 Ways of Looking, and it was mounted in the Museum of Modern Art in New York in 2006, and its curator was a MoMA curator called Farishte Daftari. Now the exhibition, which is careful not to use the word Islamic in its title, brings together 17 artists, and apart from two white American artists who are inspired by Eastern mysticism, the rest of the artists are all diaspora artists who have come from North Africa or from West Asia or South Asia, all actually artists who are ethnically from the Islamic world. About this exhibition, the curator says, the exhibition seeks to emphasize diversity by questioning the use of artists' origins as the sole determining factor in the consideration of their art. So what she means to say is that we should not see this as an exhibition of contemporary Islamic art. We should see it as an exhibition of contemporary art. We should not see it as an exhibition of contemporary Islamic art, because where these artists come from should not determine how we approach them. And yet, the show not only has artists like Shirin Nishat and Mona Hattoum and Rakib Shaw and Shadeen Gadarian and Shazia Sikandar, who are all from the right ethnicity and location, but in terms of objects, the show, or motifs, the show also concentrates on calligraphy, carpets, miniatures, and the veil. So what are you supposed to get out of seeing the show? Right. So, of course, even in the act of denying this category, the exhibition creates the category of contemporary Islamic art. And in fact, it creates the category through the act of denying it. The engagement with the problems of Islam and the problems of Middle East politics are actually completely implicit in the choice of artists and artworks. And it also creates Islam as a problem that needs to be smoothed or eased through greater understanding. Now the exhibition, which had quite a range of works, also had an audio guide. So let's listen to some extracts from the audio guide. This is the section that deals with some of the works of the well-known artist of Iranian origin, Shirin Nishat.
I am Shirin Nishat. I'm born in Iran and have been living in the United States since 1974. These two photographs are from a body of work called Woman of Allah, a photographic series that I made from 1993 until 1997. They represent the beginning of my career as an artist.
Nishat left Iran for America when she was still a teenager. On her first visit back in 1990...
Oops, sorry.
The more you're confined and you're oppressed, and the more you cover your body, the few parts that are exposed that actually become very powerful in seducing the men. Here, this whole idea of the veil and the situation that she lives in creates so much mystery about her body that her body automatically becomes an object of desire. And this is exact contradiction to what the government, the religion would like to see. But this is absolutely true about all Muslim women. They're the sexiest women, I believe, on the planet.
Shirin Nishat and Farishte Daftari, the artist and the curator, discussing the works that are in the exhibition. And it's interesting to see how the use of these voices, which are accented, they are not your professional radio announcer's voices, but they are accented voices, they carry that tinge of authenticity, that this is really the person from within who is speaking. And indeed, we do expect, and the audio guide lets us believe, that Nishat, even though she doesn't live in Iran anymore, has a special capacity for empathy with the Iranian women, has the ability to go beyond that first reaction to the veil, that everybody becomes anonymous by the veil, is able to show us how subtle sexual signaling can still happen despite the veil, and how then the people are still able to resist the government's intentions and subvert what the government wants to do, even if it's in a subtle way. Now, through this kind of narrative, we believe that Nishat can bear witness to what life is like for women in Iran, and we need Nishat to be the native and our informant and our cultural broker to tell us about these real stories about Iran. And this indeed is a role that Nishat is also quite happy to own up in the terms in which she's speaking about her work, not to mention the work itself. Now, it isn't just that exhibitions like this act like ethnographic objects which offer us a diagnostic tool to look at an entire culture, but it's also significant to see the use of the audio guide itself. And this actually brings me to the third section, the second section that I wanted to speak about today, which is about how ethnographic museums develop a special way of showing work and the kind of currency that this dioramic contextualizing mode has begun to have outside of the ethnographic museum. So if the ethnographic museum's display genre par excellence is the diorama, then I believe that there has been a tremendous resurgence in the use of the diorama today in our museum worlds, whether or not these are dioramas that we can see. Now, it's commonly understood that each genre of museum develops its own specific modes of display. And the same object will be shown very differently when it's put on display in an ethnographic museum or when it's put on display in an art museum. And when it is shown differently, it is constituted as a different kind of object altogether, with entirely different kinds of significance attributed to it and different points of interest that are highlighted about it. In an ethnographic museum, the object is usually shown in association with other objects. It may be placed in a diorama where it is used to reconstruct a contextual scene. The object is treated as a piece of evidence about that culture's way of doing things. In an art museum, the object will be isolated and very little contextual information will be given about how it is made and it is used. Instead, it is just presented to you as an object for your visual encounter, as a trigger for your aesthetic response. And even if the object is not already an aesthetic object, the way in which it is shown to you in an art museum does a very great deal to aestheticize it, so that through the form of display, you are led to a heightened awareness of the qualities of that object, right? The visual presence that it has. And this happens by isolating the object, spotlighting it, so that you remove all kinds of clutter and all kinds of context and only look at the thing in itself. Now, this kind of art museum display, which removes all the clutter and distractions and contextualizations, is known as the white cube mode of display, in which the gallery becomes a neutral envelope that shows only the artwork, and it removes everything that might distract us from the artwork. We have Brian O'Doherty with his famous critique of the white cube, whose work it is to remove every reference to context or functionality, in his words, to remove all clues that might stand in the way of the object's assessment of itself as art. So here you have this arrogant object which says, I'm beautiful, and don't you dare be distracted by anything else, you know, just look at me. And that's what the white cube does to every object that is put in it. Now, the white cube display was invented by museums of modern art, and uncharitable critics have even remarked that a lot of modern art actually needs the white cube, because without the white cube and the aura that it provides, it might not always be possible to recognize a lot of modern art as art at all. What is interesting to us, however, is to see how and when and why the white cube aesthetic gets extended beyond modern art to other categories of artifacts. Because the white cube display is meant for art, when we start applying the white cube display to a category of objects that had not been considered art up till now, by applying the white cube display, we are actually allowing that object to enter the portals of art. We are saying, yes, you're good enough to be considered art. The application of the white cube display becomes a museological gesture of approval, of inclusion into the hallowed portals of art. And clearly, allowing something in to the zone of art then becomes something of political significance. And I think you get an idea of how this works when you compare the way in which a museum in London shows Indian art, a museum in Delhi shows Asian art before independence, and then you see the same museums showing art after independence, where you can see that the different ways in which objects are shown before independence and after independence, where after independence in both London and Delhi, you have the application of the white cube aesthetic to Indian artifacts, shows how there has been a reassessment of the status of the objects that are placed in the museum. Showing Indian objects in a white cube space becomes a diplomatic necessity in London after 1947. And in Delhi, it becomes a triumphal gesture of having arrived on the world scene, that our art is no less than anybody else's. Now, through the 20th century, as the historical process of decolonization proceeds, you start finding this application of the white cube to more and more things from more and more places. Until eventually, at the end of the 20th century, you even see the extension of the white cube display to what had always been called primitive art. So you see it in the Met, you see it in the Louvre, where now suddenly primitive art objects have also been given that dignified status that is given to art of the great civilizations of the world. Exhibiting artifacts in a white cube is now de rigueur. The lack of contextualization becomes a sign that the art doesn't need to be explained. The distinction between the kind of art that needs textualization and the kind of art that doesn't need textualization becomes a kind of a ranking system, because that which is ethnographic only, not art, is a curiosity which needs to be explained. It doesn't make any sense. It has no way of communicating unless you want to know what it is about or who made it. It is culture bound and it is limited. And that which doesn't need explanation is art, and it is universally understood. And yet, of course, this is a fiction, because things do need to be explained. And particularly at these times of globalization, with all our travel and our migration and our mobility, and with all the travel and migration and mobility of artworks, when more and more audiences are seeing more and more kinds of art, of course the need to have it explained becomes more and more important. And the museum becomes a place for radical encounters, which are produced by radical displacements. Our displacements, as much as the displacements of the objects that we are contemplating, and so we want to know about these things. Indeed, multiculturalism tells us that we need to know about these things, because it is the duty of these museums to help us to understand and be sympathetic to a broader range of people through the wonderful things that they have produced. So how then can we mediate between these two contemporary pulls, which are contradictory? On the one hand, to dignify every kind of artifact with a white cube display. And on the other hand, to provide more information and more context about it. And the compromise today comes through the transference of contextual information to audio guides and to podcasts, which provide all the contextualization without giving the appearance of competing with the masterpieces, which can remain isolated in their cases. So the audio guide and the podcast are, I believe, the invisible and the unacknowledged dioramas of our times. If at one time it was obligatory to extend the aura of art to more and more objects produced by the non-West, today there is even a reverse trend with the need for contextualization felt for periods and works that are right from within the Western canon. Because as we go more distant from the times when these things were produced, they become more alien to us. And so again, the availability of an invisible diorama of the audio guide or the podcast allows us an acceptable way to offer contextualization for those kinds of things which for a long time have been seen to be just transparently great art, not needing any explanation. Of course, the need to transfer contextual information to the audio guide so that it doesn't interfere with the solitary presence of the artistic masterpiece behind its own glass case is felt by those who agree that art is the highest kind of condition for any object to attain. That if you call something art, you are paying it a compliment. However, not everybody agrees that the designation of art is the highest destiny that an object can have. And this brings me to my third theme. We know that the Ethnographic Museum has been the ground upon which a number of communities have explicitly rejected the right of the museum to transform their objects into art. They insist that the objects that their communities produced should be regarded and understood on their terms. If it's an item of worship, if it's a ritual thing, if it's a forbidden thing, it should be seen and respected as such rather than everything being homogenized into art. And at stake in their contestation of the museum's right to designate something as art, at stake here is who has the power to collect, to own, to assess, and to interpret things. Who has the right to give meaning to an object? Who should decide whether something should be subjected to a gaze inspired by reverence or a gaze that is forensic in the way it analyzes things? So in recent years, ethnographic museums have become the site of both physical and symbolic repatriations, where communities of origin now exert their moral right over objects that were taken away from their ancestors. A very big initiative in North America, in the United States, and in Canada is called NAGPRA, the Native American Graves Repatriation Act, in which those objects that were dug out of the ground, which were actually bones, which were taken away for scientific analysis, are now again being treated not as scientific exhibits, but as human beings who deserve a proper burial. And so these things are being given back to those communities who claim them to be the bones of their ancestors, and they become unavailable to science. They re-enter the ritual domain, where typically they are given a respectful burial or whatever kinds of last rites that community normally has. We are seeing one such repatriation in which human remains are being taken away by one Native American community from the Smithsonian's collections. But much as some museums are able to physically give things back to the custody of the communities of origins, there are other situations in which the physical custody cannot be transferred, and so symbolically the rights over interpretation are transferred. So how we should speak about something, how it should be catalogued and discussed, more and more museums are allowing native voices to join in the chorus of how these things should be done. Community members are consulted on what is the proper way to store something, what is the proper way to interpret it, what is the appropriate way to handle it, and how to exhibit it or whether not to exhibit it for the things that remain in their custody. These initiatives, you will note, have been taken in North America, in Australia, and in New Zealand, where in all of these places, the indigenous populations have suffered a terrible internal colonization. And as the aboriginals gain full citizenship in these countries, which in many cases comes startlingly late. For example, Australian Aboriginals used to be under the Department of Flora and Fauna until 1955. They were not considered proper human beings legally until then. So as they gain citizenship, the governments of these countries have sought to make amends, and the Ethnographic Museum becomes one of the places in which amends are sought to be made and some bad things from the past are undone. The desire to take an object out of the museum and to re-inscribe it into the former ritual life is, however, now being expressed by many groups that go well beyond these three or four Aboriginal communities. Don't you feel bad when you see our gods in their museums? A diasporic Indian once asked the art historian Tapati Guha Thakurta, prompting her to write a very fine paper on the contradictions of the circulation and the redesignation of Indian art in its career out of the temple and into the museum. Now, this kind of attitude, where an NRI feels offended that gods are put on display as art in museums, is actually in direct contrast to the earlier enthusiasm at independence, where Indians were so excited to have their objects accepted as art. At that point, the drive was to be seen as good as anybody else. And now the drive is to be different from everyone else. How dare you presume to know what our things are about? Today you have a stressing of difference, and this might derive from multiculturalism, from the rise of identity politics, it might be a defensive reaction to globalization, but more and more you're seeing groups who have civilizations, not primitive cultures, but high civilizations, who earlier had been very happy and proud to see their things being spoken of as artistic masterpieces, now insist that they should be reckoned as something else. And as more and more groups are making these kinds of new assertions that only the communities of origin have a right to custody and interpretation of the objects that issued from them, we are led to more and more contestations. And these contestations then spill over from the ethnographic museum into the art museum as well. I could cite many examples of this process in India, where, after all, we have no dearth of identity politics. We have had offerings being left in front of Buddhist relics. We have had pujas performed in front of Hindu sculptures. And we have had Sunnis attacking Ismaili manuscripts, all in museum exhibitions. But the contrary pulls and pushes on whether to artify or not, I'm going to illustrate by taking an example from my own community, which is the community of the Sikhs. In the past 15 years or so, prominent figures from within the Sikh NRI community have tried very hard to promote a very distinct and a high cultural identity for Sikhs by supporting the collection and display of artifacts made for Sikh patrons like Maharaja Ranjit Singh in prestigious art museums in the West. The fruits of the labor that they have put in, we can see in a slide like this, where we are seeing exhibitions of Sikh art as they are held in the Asian Art Museum in San Francisco, the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, the Rubin Museum in New York, and the Royal Ontario Museum in Ottawa. All of these are exhibitions that date between 1999 and 2006. So you can see how this pressure group has been working on getting this stuff accepted as a good and distinct category of art. Now, even as these primarily diasporic groups are fighting for the acknowledgement of Sikh objects as art in the sanctified space of the art museum, back in India in Chandigarh, another story was to unfold. The Chandigarh Museum was a very proud possessor of a large collection of historic manuscripts of the Guru Granth Sahib, which is the sacred book of the Sikhs. It is said that when the 10th and the last of the Sikh gurus lay dying, his followers came to him and said, "Who will succeed you? Who will be our 11th guru?" And he said, "Let the book be your guru," indicating the book which was the compilation of the writings of the previous 9 gurus. Now, he probably intended that his Sikhs should be guided by the wisdom that is contained in the book, but Sikhs have taken him very literally for his word, and they have evolved all kinds of ritual norms around the book which are very much like the worship of an idol in the temple. So the book is enthroned in the Gurdwara, it is dressed in fresh garments every day, it is woken up in the morning, it is put to bed at night, you give it warm clothes in winter and cool clothes in summer, and you have somebody waving the chori over it so that it doesn't, you know, no flies rest on it. Equally, as a living guru, when the book becomes old, if it becomes torn, it then undergoes a 7-day ritual in which it is bathed, it is dressed in white clothes, it is cremated, and then the ashes are scattered in a holy river. Now, this way of treating the Guru Granth Sahib means that old copies of the Granth Sahib are very hard to find. And it's extraordinary that there was a scholar in Chandigarh who had amassed a rare collection of manuscripts of the Guru Granth, and he gifted these in 1999 to the Chandigarh Museum, which proudly displayed them in their manuscripts gallery. Several years passed quite peacefully when suddenly a local politician burst into the museum and said, "This is disrespectful. We don't allow our holy book to be touched and seen just by anybody in the Gurdwara. It's only open when we are seeking guidance from it, and it has to be handled in a particular way. You have to have your head covered, you have to be barefoot, and this kind of way of displaying the Guru Granth is unconscionable. It is blasphemous." Now, the museum director was very nervous. He took advice from some of the granthis from Gurdwaras, and eventually he called in a priest who ritually shut the manuscript, wrapped it up in cloth, and put it back inside the case as a shut and wrapped up object. So the Guru Granth Sahib in the museum is kept in the position of the Guru Granth Sahib when it is sleeping in the Gurdwara. Predictably enough, a few weeks later, representatives from the local Muslim community came to the museum and they objected. Why are the Sikh books being given this privilege when their holy books, the Quran, is lying propped open in the museum's glass case? And so what did the museum do? It shut the Qurans and it wrapped them up in cloth. Now, to enter this gallery, all visitors have to take off their shoes, like they do in a temple. They have to cover their heads. And they walk past case after case in this gallery where all the exhibits are in plain sight but are all hidden from view. Now, when you come to a situation like this, it is very different from the kinds of concessions that are demanded by Aboriginal groups who are very small minorities. When they demand certain concessions, you know, the process has a certain kind of resonance. But when it starts being demanded by larger groups, and eventually it starts being demanded by majorities, then there are entirely different implications. If we ask what really happened in Chandigarh when the holy books of some communities were removed from the sight of unbelievers, it seems to me that this was an act that presented itself as traditional, but it was in fact a profoundly contemporary act. It took recourse to tradition in order to shore up political power in an era of identity politics. It was a refusal to submit to the museum's taxonomies in order to demonstrate a community's power to claim exceptional status for itself. And if the objects went off view as a result, let's not forget that this act of protest was also performed for the media eye, and which made the disappearance of the object itself a hyper-visible event. Now, just in case you think that, okay, there are some crazy nuts out there, there are some Aboriginal populations, that there are some crazy nuts in Punjab who are doing these kinds of things, but this is still a very marginal thing that doesn't threaten the field of art as we know it, let me draw your attention to other kinds of spheres in which similar demands and similar removals are being made. One of the most prominent being a series of claims successfully being made by the Orthodox Church in Russia, which has demanded the repatriation of Byzantine icons from museums where they were taken after the revolution and into churches. And there are several famous instances and several not so famous instances, but this is a kind of process which is going viral in Russia, where more and more objects that for decades have stayed in museums are now being claimed by the church. This dismantling of the category of art and the challenge to its authority is an extraordinarily widespread thing, and it is coming through the mobilization and the multiplication of a discourse that was first pioneered by the Ethnographic Museum, but we are seeing it playing out in many, many places today. Excuse me. Let me move now to the fourth and final theme for today, where we see how Europe is provincialized and the Enlightenment itself becomes a kind of an ethnic particular. Now, at the time that we are seeing a number of people in a number of places rebuking the museum and saying you have no right to recontextualize our objects, you are also seeing the exact contrary trend. And in many places all over the world, we are seeing museums growing rapidly where there was not a strong presence of museums before. So the art museum or the artifying museum, which is rejected by some, is eagerly welcomed by others at the very first same time. If we take a look at the staggering speed and scale at which China is acquiring museums, where you have 1,000 museums that have come up or are recently coming up on Chinese soil, you can see that the ambition of this project is actually announced in the kind of architecture of these museums, where they intend to be spectacular, they intend to be contemporary, and they are imprinting a story of arrival, economic arrival, social arrival, cultural arrival, cosmopolitan arrival, upon the entire map of China. I was at a conference where a government spokesman from China was announcing the Chinese authorities' plan to build 1,000 museums in the next few years. And we all asked him what they intended to put in the museum. His answer was that even as the buildings are being raised on the ground, archaeologists are digging into it, and they are going to find the artifacts that will fill the hall. And this being China, of course they will. They will find enough artifacts to fill all 1,000 museums. But there are also museums in China which have the ambition to go well beyond the national. And you have the Museum of World Cultures being announced at Beijing, which wants to collect examples from all the major civilizations of the world in the manner of the British Museum or the Metropolitan Museum, museums that one had thought you would need to be living in an earlier age to be able to construct, but they seem to be able to do it in the here and now. Another concentration of very major art museums may be seen in the Gulf states. The centerpiece of the Gulf ambitions has to be the very widely discussed plan for a museum district on Saadiyat Island in Abu Dhabi. Today, after the recession, it looks as though this project may never be completed, or may never be completed at the kind of pitch at which it was announced. But the extraordinary scale of the plans, the spread of publicity and marketing about it, and the fever pitch of journalistic and academic discussion about this has made Saadiyat Island a spectacular and a real presence, even as it remains unbuilt. Among what was planned for the Saadiyat Island was a branch of the Guggenheim by Frank Gehry. Sorry, that's what you're seeing in the foreground here. There were plans for a Louvre being built by Jean Nouvel, another very fine architect. There were plans for a maritime museum, partly underwater, by Tadeo Ando. And there were plans for an Emirati National Museum by Norman Foster, and a performing arts center by Zaha Hadid. Zaha Hadid was also commissioned to develop a museum of contemporary art by Bahrain. But these are all plans. All of the Abu Dhabi and the Bahrain projects are still plans. But at the turn of the millennium, Saudi Arabia built itself a national museum in Riyadh with 100,000 square feet of gallery space devoted exclusively to the archaeology and the history of the Saudi kingdom. And the presence of a museum like this, you know, making a museum like this for the first time in a particular place, actually has a social logic of its own. Because after this museum was built, Saudi Arabia started giving tourist visas for the first time. But the Arab thunder has really been stolen by Qatar, because even as Abu Dhabi was announcing and then revising and then announcing postponements of its grand plans, in Qatar's capital in Doha in 2008, they already opened a very remarkable building built by IMP for the Museum of Islamic Art. Now, this museum houses a staggeringly important and very fine collection of Islamic art. So it's a truly remarkable museum, not least because it shows that if you have the will and you have infinite amounts of money, you can build the most extraordinary collections even today. Joining the Museum of Islamic Art at Doha 2 years later was Mathaf, the Arab Museum of Modern Art. It's only a few years old, but it's already made its mark with some really remarkable shows. Here you're seeing views of a very large and ambitious solo exhibition by the Chinese megastar artist Chai Guo Chang, who is known for the controlled explosions that he does. And it was followed by a charming and a difficult and a challenging show called Tea with Nefertiti, which invited contemporary artists to engage with the difficult history of archaeology in the region. So clearly this is a place that has money, it has oomph, and it has intellectual horsepower as well. Wonderful as all of this is, the ambition to have such museums in these places should really give us pause. And we should ask what it means to have these museums in these places at this time. The idea that a museum in a new place will only repeat what its ancestor did in the old place, huh? That the Louvre in Abu Dhabi is going to do what the Louvre in Paris did, is such a ridiculous idea that we have to dismiss that thought even as we formulate it. Because an old form of a museum, and not all of the museums in the Gulf are going to follow old forms, but even an old form of a museum in a new location is going to be a new proposition. It's going to be inserted into a new context, a new history, a new demography, and a new politics. So it has to mean something new in this other place. To my mind, this global spread of the art museum now inscribes the cultural form of the museum upon the landscape. And as it does so, it sets up new chains of meaning that derive from the museum's very newness in the place in which it finds itself. And I want to suggest that as we learn to consume an old museum in a new location, we learn to savor not just the museum's contents, but the museum itself as an artifact. That as an artifact itself that represents a particular culture, the culture that made museums. So what is collected through this particular maneuver then is Europe. And so finally, Enlightenment Europe begins to appear as a kind of an ethnic particular. And the fact that it can today be collected by China or by the Gulf becomes a signal for anyone who wants to listen about the shifts that have occurred in power and in economy, about who has the capacity to collect and which is the other that it is collecting. But let me end this by sharing with you a conversation that I had not so long ago, which helped me to understand this phenomenon of the global spread of museums from a more intimate perspective. Among all the other places where new museums have been so remarkably efflorescent in recent years is the little city-state of Singapore. And politically incorrect as it may be, I adore Singapore. And when I first visited it, I was absolutely taken aback by the range and the quality and the sophistication of its museums. So I visited its very up-to-date contemporary art museum. I was impressed by its fabulous and ambitious Asian Civilizations Museum. And I was completely staggered by its very high-tech and uber-cool National Museum that tells the history of Singapore through the most beguiling high-tech storytelling methods. Not only were these institutions very remarkable to visit, but they all came into being in a period of 10 years, from the middle 1990s till about 2006. As an admirer of many of these museums then, I was completely delighted when I was at a conference dinner and I found myself seated next to Kenson Kwok, who was the brilliant founding director of the Asian Civilizations Museum, who had managed to put together this world-class institution in just a few years. So I asked him, why is the government investing so much in so many museums so suddenly? And he gave me many answers of exactly the kind that you would expect. He said, we have a responsibility towards our people, we have a responsibility towards culture, towards heritage, it's for education. And at the end of all of this, he said, and it helps us to hold on to a better quality of expatriate. It helps us to hold on to a better quality of expatriate. So I thought about what he was saying and what kinds of function the museum has to perform now. You can see that all these ambitious plans for new mega museums are emerging in the places of new wealth. And as these places all play increasingly important roles in the global economy, to be successful, these places have to offer a certain kind of infrastructure. They have to upgrade themselves. And the infrastructure that they offer has to go beyond roads and airports and electricities, and it has to extend to other forms as well. The more that each of these places that is a node in the growing global economy, the more it is like other nodes in the global economy, the better chance that place will have of holding on to its Swedish engineers, its Chinese entrepreneurs, and its British financial analysts in one place. And so I think of this growing population of expatriates moving from Bucharest to Dubai to Shanghai, going everywhere after work to the jazz club, sending their children to international schools, their wives becoming the friends of the museum. And I see these people then becoming like little figures that are moving around inside the diorama of the global cosmopolis. Thank you very much. Yes, please.
Why?
People are getting free. Madam, when people are getting free, the museums are closing. Now, how to engage the people? 11 to 14 years, 8 to 9 to 10 standard students, colleges, young lovers, couples, birthdays, anniversaries must have in the museums. So that will bring people. Use holidays, Diwali, Christmas, May holidays as attractions. Have cultural engagement of rural, urban, western and vernacular flock, dances, songs, poetry, museums. Use vertical cutouts. You're having horizontal, so you're using a lot of space. Then have takeaway booklets, pamphlets. Then you have an amphitheater, pandal and aerodromes. Have training of global arts and different arts. Have discussions on books or arts. Then have contest competitions of different art colleges, so that will bring the people. Have different area cluster exhibitions. Have daily lectures, internet webinars, videos. Have different ranges, locales, locations. Now the main thing, madam, you have missed out is, see, have top ceilings showing down flow, or have flow exhibits on the flow. Then have cross-section society exhibits. Have how to explain the exhibits. Have running indicators explaining the exhibits. You put an indicator there, like a railway platform indicator. And why not have mobile tablets, computer type more arts, and have religious exhibits, have different issues, and have newspaper exhibits and lawyers, doctors, conclaves. And the main thing, madam, is that one more thing you missed out, have different walls of arts, like terraces, gardens, parks, flyovers, why not have video exhibits? You have drawing exhibits, why not have video exhibits? People like that have travel exhibits. So that way more people, and have more discussions every day on different subjects. So that will bring this. So how to engage the youth? Old people will come, but the youth have to come in from 11 to 25 years. So that postgraduate students, business students, MBA students, that we have to bring in. Thank
You're
you, madam.
Absolutely right, but why don't you put all of this in a letter so that the museum authorities can go through your suggestions step by step and see what they can possibly do. Very good idea. Excellent. Please write it out and leave it at the museum. Thank you.
Thank you for the most political talk I've heard in a long time. And I'm actually in the field of anthropology, so this is all very...
It's coming a bit muffled, I think. This is the kind of mic you have to...
Okay, so I said thank you for the most political talk I've heard in a very long time in the art world. And I'm from the field of anthropology, so this is all very familiar to me in a sense that the anthropologist also is... The anthropologist is also doing the same. It's the trajectory is entirely the same in the West. We think subaltern school happened, but it actually only added to something that was problematic, and the subaltern cannot speak is what the archive says. So what I wanted to ask you, I mean, there's just a series of questions, but one of the first questions is, would you be able to comment on a Mark Rothko exhibition, Tate? Or is the hegemony and the hierarchy.
No, actually I'm blank on that. Sorry, I've not been, is there something I should have been following?
No, in the sense that how
much more open, and some of it has to do with structures that are impediments, and some of it has to do with our own narcissism. Because contemporary art is something that is cosmopolitan, you know, it has to be. And even that tends to be narcissistic, where those of us from India are primarily only interested in India, or at the most India and Pakistan. But if you look at Indian art historians, you know, where are you going to find somebody who's willing to even move one inch out of India? The collapse of our horizons to within the framework of the nation state is something absolutely appalling and injurious. And yet nationalism is, you know, did this to us, and we continue to let it do it to us. But I think it's more a question of choice than of absolute prohibition.
Okay. Choice, but you know,
we choose to be
okay. We choose to be
only in ourselves,
in a sense, essentialized.
Yeah,
in the same form that the native is. I mean, in a sense, also because our disciplinary practices are such that we land up studying more on India, right? The other thing was on the colonial museum, on the ethnographic museum. Would you see the national museums and the science museum as a binary to the ethnographic? Because in the national museums, like in France and all this, the national or the Dutch, it's completely devoid of the colony in one way. And they kind of work out as a very interesting binary. And the, actually, the mediator is the science museum, because it's the science museum which is the conquest is based on particular artifacts of science. So would you see the ethnographic museum and the national museums in these places as binaries?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a perfect observation on your part, because each one tells its history as though it's not implicated in the other history, or it has no connection. And that is absurd, but that is what part of the dialogue in recent years, or certainly the self-examination of art history has, not art history, of anthropology has been. I think art history has done less self-examination than anthropology, until recently, perhaps, until the last 5 years.
One last question, sorry. You mentioned in the end about the Chinese and the Arab world collecting, and the kind of power, money, economy, hegemony moving, and they're getting their Louvres in.
Yeah.
I wasn't very clear about it, because in a sense they're also moving and appropriating and legitimizing through the same archival framework of the West. It's kind of like, can there be an Indian museum? Because the museum in itself is placed.
Yeah, they are and they aren't. I'm not so sure about the Arab case, but in the case of China, there is an interest in exchange with Western museums. But Chinese museums, when they speak about the heritage of China, actually do not even use the framework of art. You know, they call it cultural relics, and they don't have the kind of linear programming that art history has, where you're going to put a sculpture next to another sculpture and you're going to put a textile next to another textile. Instead, they have a more fluid notion about periods where certain things are produced, and that strict demarcation of this is high art and this is low art, this is a box, therefore it's decorative and it cannot be put next to a sculpture, that is not followed in China. Interestingly, it's not followed in Japan already, where if you look at what are the genres within our art history, Indian art history is actually very slavish to Western art history, because our chapters are sculpture, architecture, painting. If you look at China and Japan, it'll be kimonos, it'll be fans, it'll be screens. We have never thought of studying those things, though by far one of the most important cultural productions in India through its entire history has been textile. But we do not work on it with the kind of seriousness that it deserves.
China would be very interesting vis-a-vis the Cultural Revolution,
yes,
right? Because they've just taken it to...
So yes, it would be a very interesting case, and therefore the terms on which the cultural reconstruction is done after the Cultural Revolution, and then the kind of terms in which the insertion into a global dialogue about what, you know, about museums, heritage, exhibitions, and the razzmatazz that goes with it, those terms are interesting to study.
Thank you. I have other questions, but later.
Madam, do you not think that this rise in making new museums, like in China or Middle East, is becoming rather a status symbol?
Yes.
Because the architecture of these buildings, otherwise a museum can be a box.
Yes.
But the way they are employing these architects, I mean, they're, yes, good, they're good architects, great architects, but they are becoming status symbol. And you go to Bilbao, and I'm told that most people go to Bilbao to see the museum and not the content of the museum. So don't you think that the museums are actually just status symbols, like carrying a Mont Blanc in pocket or something like that?
Yes, they are.
And are the people concerned about the content at all?
Well, and obviously someone has to be concerned about the content, because you're not going to leave the museum empty. So you will have a stream of professionals who will be working on the content. And whether the content is going to be entirely local, as in the Saudi National Museum, where they had to find enough stuff to put in it, with all of their concerns about figurative sculptures or pre-Islamic figurative things could not be shown, but you want to show only Saudi things. You know, so there are complications in every place about how you will display, what you will display. But you're right that a lot of these museums are actually simply signs.
Yes,
they're just
symbols.
Signs upon the landscape. However, let us rewind 120 years. Where exactly the same kind of process that you see unfolding in the Gulf or in China today was happening in the United States, which was also this jungly place where all of these robber barons were vacuuming up the culture from old Europe and using their newfound wealth to make these huge buildings, which were considered as, you know, upstartish and as nouveau-riche as we think of the things in the Gulf or China today. And today nobody would say that 100 years on those museums are not important or significant or in some way deeply entrenched, you know. So we're looking at a moment in history.
Okay. And most of these museums are out of context to the location also.
The location, but you know, bringing a lot of out of context things into the location changes the location. So the location isn't what the location was 2 years ago.
Okay, thank you.
People go to see Dubai to see the architecture now. I mean, it's not like cultural monuments, but just to see the architecture of the commercial buildings. It's produced something. It's produced, you know, an entity which didn't exist before.
Do we have any other questions? Yeah.
Thank you so much. It was a fascinating talk, and you began with telling us how it's not like we lose sleep over, you know, the subject of your talk, but you've gone on to illustrate how relevant it is, I think, across the museum. In fact, I'm a non-fiction filmmaker, and for some reason, documentaries especially seem to carry this anthropological kind of and I see all of that, you know, you're illustrating out here, extending to the film festival field, for instance, you know, where it began, and then it's being taken on, you know, in Busan, and very similar sites, you know. So thank you. It really gives us a lens through which to investigate the kind of cultural brokering that one is expected to do.
Thank you. It's very interesting. Thank you for putting that in my frame. Thank you very much. Okay, every question that is now asked stands between me and a glass of beer. Please ask your question.
Good evening, ma'am, and we really appreciate the presentation here. It was something which made us think a lot more about the museums of today that we were introduced by you, and that seems to fascinate all of us. There's just one question I would want to ask you. Don't you think that museums of today have an element of inside out? Because the kind of architecture that represents or maybe seems to contain the content seems to be inside out, as somebody rightly
pointed
out.
Seeing the exterior. We actually had a whole session about museum architecture in the course yesterday.
Okay.
Museums have become the site for a lot of architectural license, in which they have become the kind of project in which an architect can come close to being an artist. And because of something that they've been involved in, it sets a trend where it produces very effective results, and many people want that replicated, and then artists get the chance to go wild in like museum buildings. That said, why should we think that the museum building has less of a right to be spectacular and monumental than, say, the Taj Mahal? Because if Bilbao, Guggenheim is calling people to Bilbao, Agra's Taj Mahal is calling people to Agra, there's no other reason to go there. And we don't have a problem with that. So maybe we should not also have a problem with these also being those occasions or opportunities to produce major architectural monuments in our days. In the 1600s, it was tombs, and today maybe it's museums. Okay.
So you mentioned that you know, Indians don't really go out of India, and you know, like in terms of art, like we are too full of ourselves.
Art history, we study art history, are only interested in ourselves.
But I've observed that, you know, as kids also, when we are growing up, we are never exposed to the world art, you know. So for me, it's like when I see people abroad, like visiting museums in London or something, kids are really taught on weekends, and they are like, it started here, but it was never when I was growing up. So maybe that's why we are only, you know, it's a major thing, like, you know.
You know, this is a deceptively simple question. I'm afraid it has a very long answer, and it has an answer which is connected to history, because who can have the opportunities to be cosmopolitan, and when? Today, you and I can actually find out about a lot of things in the world because the internet has brought information within our reach. Prior to that, who could actually know about a lot of things? You had to be fortunate enough to live in one of the metropolises of the world. Which are the metropolises of the world? Those places which had very significant roles in the 19th century economy. No? So if you were living in Paris or London, you would grow up with those opportunities, not because Paris and London are nice, but because Paris and London were the capitals of colonies.
So as museums in India, isn't it like one of the things we should become more accepting to other
people? Yeah, it can be done through many things. To, you know, museums are a special kind of place, and they're a specially expensive kind of place. So to have museums and to demand that our museums should be bigger and better and have Greek sculpture and Egyptian sculpture in them is asking for a certain economic investment and a certain kind of aggressiveness, which I don't like. But today we have other channels by which to broaden our horizons, not just acquiring things, but we can learn without physically picking things up. And I think we should look at those. We shouldn't actually think about being colonial masters of today. Luckily, we're so disorganized as a country that we're never going to get there. So there's no fear about our grandchildren feeling guilty about having colonized the world. We are sparing them that burden. Okay, good night, everybody.